Welcome to week two in our Advent series. You know, we're getting ready for Christmas. Can you believe it? It's just around the corner. I don't know how many shopping days that means for those who shop. If you're shopping online, God bless you. That's an amazing, easy way to do that. But, you know, as you're kind of getting ready, getting things all settled today, why not invite someone to join you today online as you're watching this? It's simple, just click the button, send it out to a friend, and have them participate with you today. We would love for you to say hi. Say hi in the chat room, we will say hi back. We miss you like crazy, and so it's just great to be worshiping together with you. Let's go now into worship.
The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. Oh my God, you never will. Oh my God, you never fail. Cause I'm gonna see a victory, I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. Cause I'm gonna see a victory, I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. Every war he wages, he will win. Oh, I'm not backing down from any giant. Yeah, cause I know how this story ends. Yes, I know. Cause I know how this story ends. Cause I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. So I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. Yeah, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. Cause I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turned it for good. Yeah, you turned it for good. Oh, you take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. Yeah, you turn it for good. Oh, you take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. Yeah, you turn it for good. Victory, yeah, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. Oh, for the battle, oh, all belongs to you, God. So I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory for the battle. You take.
so good to worship with you today. I know we're not in the same space, but I sense the presence of God is moving. He's moving where you are. He's moving where we are today. So, you know, I know in this global pandemic, it's brought a sense of isolation and so many other challenges. And I just want to assure you today that if you're feeling isolated, if you're feeling disconnected, hey, don't do life alone. Do it together in community. We would love to be that community that you can call upon, that you can be in relationship with today. So it's really simple. You can do that in a couple ways today. If you want someone to pray with you, we would love to do that. Just click on the live prayer button there and you'll have one of our team pray with you today. If you want to connect with us on a deeper level and you want to get to know us a little bit more, or you got some questions that you just need some resolve to, please connect at myjourney.church and we'll do our best to connect with you. We're so glad you're here today and we just want to make sure that you're served well.
Hello, Journey Church. I'm Brenda and I serve as your treasurer. I'm here to share with you two giving opportunities that we have coming up in the next few weeks. The first opportunity will take place on Sunday, December 20th. I would like to invite you to participate with us as we show our appreciation to our pastoral staff through the Love Our Pastors offering. The landscape of ministry has rapidly changed this year and continues to evolve. Our church pastors have led our church family with wisdom and love, making difficult decisions on a daily basis to keep us connected through online and in-person services and socially distanced events, while still making every effort to keep the vulnerable amongst us safe and healthy. I know this has not been easy for our pastors, and they have had to care for many of us as we navigated the personal challenges each of us has faced during the pandemic. This offering is a practical way for us to honor our pastoral staff and to show appreciation for their sacrifices and care this year. The best way to give is by using the Tithely app. Be sure to select the Love Our Pastors option in the Give To field. If you're at our in-person service, you can also use a point of sale machine at the Connect Corner, or you can use one of the other methods of giving that are now on the screen. The second opportunity will take place on Christmas Eve, December 24th. We will receive a special offering to support families in need connected to our church during this Christmas season. You know, when I was young, Christmas was a difficult time of year for my parents. Not only were they far away from home, their families, but there was also the added financial pressure. My dad was a PhD student and my mom worked multiple jobs to make ends meet. They did all they could to provide for their four children. I have vivid memories of our church family filling our pantry and fridge with food and providing us with Christmas gifts during those lean years. This was a huge gift for my parents and left a lasting imprint on my heart. I'm incredibly thankful for the generosity of the church family that brightened our Christmas season many years ago, and I'm excited to be in a position now to pay forward the generosity and the love that was shown to my family. I know personally that what seems like a small gesture can have a lasting impact on families in need. Again, the best way to give is by using the Tithely app. Select Benevolence in the Give To field. If you're at our church service, again, you can use the point of sale machine in our Connect Corner or use one of the other giving methods on the screen. I know 2020 has been a stressful year, to say the least, and many people in our community have been impacted. I ask that you take time to pray and see what you're able to give to honor our pastors and to support the families connected to our community that are in need this Christmas. Thank you in advance for your generosity and support.
So as we prepare to give today, you know, I'm reminded of something that the Apostle Paul talked about in Acts 20, verse 35. Actually, this is something that Jesus was saying. He said, it's more blessed to give than it is to receive. Now, I remember this verse as a kid, and I've heard this verse misquoted and quoted incorrectly or misused, especially at Christmas time, you know. And I just want to remind you today that God, it is more blessed to give than it is to receive. And so I want to say thank you for your generosity. Thank you for how you have made a difference in the lives of people. You're helping those who are feeling isolated come into community together. And you have a big part to play there. So thanks for that. Thanks for supporting this ministry, enabling us to reach people all around the world, essentially. But if you haven't participated, if you haven't taken that step of faith to trust the Lord in this area of your life, I want to challenge you today. Why not start today? Because the Lord wants to bless you. He wants you to live in the obedience that He's provided for you. And as you walk with Him, watch to see how this scripture will come to life in your own way, for your life. And so we made it really simple. There's a number of ways to follow through on this. Just take a look at the screen today, and we would love to see how God is faithful in your life. Thanks so much for your faithfulness.
Good morning, church. We're so glad that you're with us for Journey Church Online. Well, it's Advent season. We're 3 weeks away from Christmas. And you know, like I said last week, for thousands of years, the church has been celebrating Advent. And for thousands of years, 4 weeks before Christmas, they begin to tell the Christmas story. And for most of my adult life, I could not see the importance of this, why year after year I had to teach on the same story. But the more that I have lived, the more that I have understood, as C.S. Lewis once said, that the real job of every moral teacher is to keep bringing us back time after time to the old simple principles which we are all so anxious not to see. Like bringing a horse back and back to the fence it has refused to jump, or bringing a child back and back to the bit in its lesson that it wants to shirk. And I think that this is really true about the Advent season. If we fail to teach about the centrality of the manger and the cross, then we are merely teaching about how to live a good moral life. And while this is important, it doesn't set men and women free. This Advent season, I want to teach about what it means to make room for Jesus in our lives. Because although this was a literal ancient problem, there was no room for Jesus in the inn, this is actually a great word picture for many of our lives, that we often don't have room for Jesus in our lives, particularly as life sort of begins to return to normal. We see that the pace of our life begins to pick up. And if we're not careful, we'll be so busy doing other things that we won't make room for Jesus in our lives. The Advent story shows us in real time how we are to make room for Jesus. And the interesting thing is that when we make room for Christ in our lives, He somehow makes room for other things in our lives. The book of Matthew, Jesus talks about this. He says, "Seek first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added to you." And there's really no other way to describe this except for God economics. He has a way of enlarging our ability to take things in, and we're thankful for that. Today, I want to talk about making room for the direction of God in our lives. We all want direction, don't we? But we often don't want to do the work that comes with direction. Think about the last time you went to your doctor and he gave you direction for your eating habits or weight loss or whatever it may be. We often are good at hearing direction and then not doing anything about it. I learned this very early in my career. I owned a tutoring business, and I soon learned that while most people have goals, they don't necessarily want to do the work to achieve those goals. Everybody wants to be a doctor or a lawyer, but not everybody wants to do the work to pass the MCAT or the LSAT. I think the same is true with direction from God. We all want direction from God, but we don't often want the implications of that direction. In essence, what we want is direction from ourselves that we call direction from God, which really is the essence of idolatry. Luke 2, chapter 8, gives us this really amazing passage about shepherds who receive direction from God. And I want to read the passage today, and then we're going to talk about it. It says, "And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, 'Don't be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger.' Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, 'Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom His favor rests.' When the angels left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, 'Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about.' So they hurried off, and they found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning all that had been told about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. So the question that we begin with when we talk about direction and making room for Jesus is, what kinds of people does God speak to and give direction to? It's interesting because I think if you grew up in North America, you grew up hearing, or you grew up in a Christian, kind of a Judeo-Christian country, you grew up hearing this story, this Advent story, and somehow we have amalgamated shepherds with like kind of spiritual people. But history doesn't tell us that that is the truth at all. The Bible, the very fact that God chose shepherds tells us that God is no respecter of people. Shepherds were nobodies in ancient Hebrew culture. They were actually the lowest on the totem pole. The fact that God came and spoke to shepherds tells us so much about the character of God, who he is, and that, as the Bible tells us, that he is no respecter of people. He doesn't care what you're like or how you're perceived, if you're on the top of the heap or the bottom of the heap. It tells us that everybody is a candidate for God's direction. And I think at the beginning we have to ask ourselves this question: why does God give us direction? Like, why would the God of the universe, the God who's created all the planets, all the solar system, our earth, everything conceivable to man, why would he even bother to give us direction? And I think there's two reasons for it, and both of them are important. The first is this, is that God wants you to flourish. He's a good God, the Bible tells us, who gives us good gifts. He wants to give you direction so that you will prosper. That is the Bible. That is not some name it and claim it theology. That is the Bible that says he wants us to prosper even as our soul prospers, every part of our life. And so he does want to give us direction because he loves you. And that tells us about that God cares about the very minutiae in your life. Jesus talked about this when he said, listen, God clothes the lilies. They look so beautiful. He cares about the sparrows. Of course he cares about you. So he cares about us enough to give us direction and show us what to do and where we're to go. The second reason, though, and this is often forgotten, if this second reason is forgotten, we get into weird rabbit's foot Jesus, like he's just a genie in the sky. The second reason God would give us direction is because he wants to be glorified. His purposes are always higher than ours. He might show you exactly how you can get that promotion, but it's so that you will flourish, but also so that he will get glorified in your life. He told the shepherds about a newborn king so that they would be blessed and be able to go see him, but also so that God would get the glory, so that Jesus would be worshiped. And these two things are always combined. God gives us direction so that we will flourish and so that his name will be glorified. Okay, so now we have to ask ourselves the question, if all of us are a candidate to hear from God, and he wants to give all of us direction, he wants all of us to flourish, and he wants his name to be glorified, what stops us from getting direction from God? And I think there's a couple of things, and we can see this in this picture in the shepherds. There could have been a number of responses of the shepherds. We don't have any indication from Scripture that the shepherds were forced to listen to the angel. We don't have any indication from Scripture that they were forced to go and worship the king. So I think there's a few responses that tell us why we often don't get it. Number one, we fail to listen. Sometimes we let temporal worries get in the way of eternal things. And I was kind of thinking about the shepherds. What if the shepherds had gone, listen, we gotta worry about our sheep here. Really sorry, angel, but we're quite busy. There are wolves out here, and sorry. I think that's something a lot of us do. We let temporal things get in the way of eternal things. So we slough off gathering together with church because, like, I got work to do. University students, we often say, well, I got homework to do. And when I'm done, And so, or we don't read our Bibles because, like, I got things. But we're always going to have things. And so we fail to hear from God. We fail to get direction from Him because we fail to listen. I think sometimes it's because we're terrified of what He'll say. Some of us are bold by nature, and this will not even, you won't even resonate with this at all. But others of us are more timid by nature. And you read these encounters that people had with angels and you think, God, never me. I remember when one of our kids was little, we read them the story about Moses and the burning bush. And for an entire 3 or 4 years, their prayer at night was, Dear Jesus, please keep me safe and please don't come to me like you came to Moses. Please, no dreams. I don't want anything about Moses. And it was kind of hilarious because they could barely talk, but for years they prayed this. And Dave and I were like, what kind of a family are we raising that they're praying, God, don't come to me? But for some of us, this is a very real thing. We don't want to get direction from God because we're kind of terrified. And part of that is, I think we got to do a little bit of work in saying, God, would you show up with your love in my life so I don't have to be terrified of you? The thing is, we don't have to be terrified of God. He's a God of love and grace and peace, and He wants to come to us and give us direction in a way that that we can hear. Some of us, we don't get direction from God because we don't believe He could give us direction. Some of you have maybe grown up in a tradition that has told you that God no longer speaks to people, and I just want to encourage you to continue to search the scriptures. Time and time again, God came to His people, and I believe He still comes to us and can give us direction and understanding and wisdom. And finally, we sometimes don't get direction from God because we hear Him, but then we fail to act. And this is maybe the most egregious reason why we don't get direction from God. We hear Him, we know what He's saying, but then we decide we're not going to listen. And I could tell you, I mean, we could be here all day where I could tell you the times that I've heard God and then not been obedient to Him. Great news is our God is merciful and gracious. So if you're normal, you've probably had opportunities like this where you've heard God and then for whatever reason, you just haven't been obedient. But the amazing thing is that God continues to give us mercy and grace. And our job is to say to Him, God, today I want to hear your direction and I want to follow you. And to be obedient. Okay, so then the question becomes, how does God give us direction? Because I think if we're all looking for an experience like the shepherds had, we would know from Scripture that this is not always how God comes to people. In fact, it is rarely how He comes to people. There's a couple really very clear ways that God comes to us, and the first one is through His Word. I know that during times of great sorrow and anxiety in my life, that God's word has spoken to me and has changed the course of my own life. Psalm 119, 105 says, "Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path." God's word illuminates the ways that we should go. And I can tell you, many, many times in my life when I haven't known what to do, when Dave and I have just been seeking the face of God for what we should do, it's like when we open up His Word, He begins to show us exactly what we should do and where we should go. And these are not always like, clearly the words don't change, like you should go down Center Street and then. But God will show us in His Word how we are to live. When we began asking the Lord, what is it that He wanted us to do? And you're going to be hearing about this over the next number of weeks and months as we began to ask God what it was that Journey Church was supposed to be about. I just began to have a time where I was seeking God in His Word like I never have before. I was feeling like the pandemic had pulled everything out from underneath us, and so God, like, what is it that we're to do? We can't just do nothing, although there were moments I wanted to do nothing. You know, as I began to read His Word, I began to see all through Scripture from Genesis to Revelation, He just began illuminating His heart for the poor amongst us, His heart for the downtrodden amongst us. And God began to wake both Dave and I up in the night with ideas of what we could do to serve our community and serve those who who are in need. And so in the coming weeks and months, you're going to hear about some of those opportunities that we're going to have to reach out to our community. But I believe that the Lord has spoken to us, and He spoke to us through His Word. More times than not, God will speak to us through His Word, which is why we've got to be tuned into His Word. We believe that the Holy Spirit is the illuminator of God's Word. So you're reading the Bible, but the Holy Spirit's reading along with you and showing up and highlighting things to you. So I would encourage you, maybe you've never read the Bible before, this would be a great time to start maybe in Luke's Gospel and read the Christmas story and then continue reading on to the life of Jesus. God's going to show up in your life. He's going to show you things, direct you, tell you where to go. Maybe you're in a hard season in your life. When my little brother died, I was in the hardest season of my life. I had a number of things. The bottom of my boat had just fallen out. And if I'm honest, the Bible was maybe the last thing I wanted to read, but I just knew that if I was going to get through this season, that I had to cling on to something. So I just started reading the Bible. And every time I'd read it, God would speak to me in those moments, healing my heart and reminding me that now is not forever. So maybe you're in a hard spot right now. I want to encourage you to get into the Word of God and begin to ask God to give you direction. The second way that God gives us direction is through His voice. Scripture is also clear that God continues to speak to us and offer us direction straight from His voice. We believe that we can hear the voice of the Holy Spirit. John 10:27 says, "My sheep hear My voice, and I know them, and they follow Me." All throughout the New Testament, we see God's people living and working by the direct word of the Lord. The Holy Spirit loves to speak to us and give us knowledge of His plans for us. Growing up, my dad would always say to me, the Holy Spirit's always going to want to give you direction. The question is, are you willing to listen? And we've always taught our kids this. I've told you this before, that we always have a little time at night where we listen for the voice of God. And when we made the decision to move here from Ontario, we said to our kids, we feel like the Holy Spirit is telling us that this is the place we're to come and live. But we want you to listen to the voice of the Lord as well. We want you to, and our middle son had gone to bed that night crying. He didn't want to leave. He was worried about grandma and grandpa. I mean, he had a million 10-year-old concerns. And I guess he was nine-year-old concerns. And he went to bed just weeping. And he doesn't cry very often. He's kind of like a somber child. And I was worried. I said to Dave, I don't know if we can do this. Like, if our kids are not behind this, I can't have my kids like hate me for this move for the rest of my life. And I remember Dave saying, we're just going to trust that if the Lord's spoken to us, He'll speak to our kids. So that night we put our kids to bed, and in the morning our middle son got up right away. He came down to the breakfast table. It was a Saturday morning, and he said, Mom and Dad, I heard from God last night. He told me it was good that we were going to move, that You've heard from God. And He gave me a picture of friends that I'm going to have, a picture of the friends I'm going to have. And, you know, that word from the Lord has sustained him and the rest of our children for many days. The funny thing was, once our son had heard from God, the other kids were all like, well, if he's heard from God, I guess we can all trust that God's in this. And He has been in it. It's been amazing. I just think if we will begin to say, God, would You speak to me and give me very specific direction? Mom and Dad, if you'll speak that way to your children, get them to get words from God, it will change the way that we live our lives. What's interesting is that we can get a word from God, not just for ourselves, direction for God, not just for ourselves, but for other people as well. And we see this in the New Testament when people began to work it with the gifts of the Holy Spirit. So we believe that we can get direction from God's Word. We believe that we can hear the voice of the Holy Spirit ourselves, but we also can get direction from God through His servants. Again, I don't know why I was thinking about this. I think we've been here 5 years now, and so I've been somewhat nostalgic about this, but I was thinking about when we were making the decision to come here. One of our church members, a Journey Church member, called Dave. He just said, Dave, listen, I woke up and I don't normally do this. I know you're contemplating this decision. In fact, at the time we had said, no, we didn't think that the Lord was calling us here. He just called us and said, I had a vision from God, and take it as you will. And he gave Dave the vision, and Dave came home and told me, and we said, well, we better pray about that. And as we prayed about it, it began to be like a confirmation that God was calling us here. 1 Peter 4:11 says, if anyone speaks, let him speak as the oracles of God. This idea that we can hear from God for other people is really, really important. At Journey Church, listen, we're a church that believes in the gifts of the Holy Spirit, and those gifts are meant for edification, exhortation, and comfort, the Bible tells us. And that means that maybe some of you are going to be praying today, and you'll get a word of direction for somebody else. I want to encourage you to begin to step out in those gifts. The worst thing that can happen is you'll say something wild and someone will go, I don't know, that doesn't really resonate with me. Big deal. Nobody was hurt in the filming of this. We can move from there. He can help us. Sometimes you have an inkling of something. You believe you've heard God's voice and another person can come and just give confirmation to that. And that's such a wonderful thing. So in the next few minutes, here's what I want to do. We're going to do something a little bit different than we normally do. Normally I just close now and we're going to pray that you'd hear the voice of God. But I actually want us to go through a little bit of an exercise here. Just in this moment, wherever you're sitting, wherever you're watching this, I want you just for a moment to meditate on God's desire and ability to offer you direction through his word and his voice. Just listen to these scriptures. This is what it means to meditate, to ruminate on God's word. So Psalm 119 says this, your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. Psalm 37:23 says, the steps of a man are established by the Lord when he delights in his way. John 10:27 says, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. Just in the quietness of this moment, would you just say, God, I trust that you can give me direction, just as you gave the shepherds direction to go to the manger, just as you gave the shepherd's direction to go and worship Jesus. I believe that you can give me direction for my own life. Second part of this is, where do you need God's direction in your life today? Where do you need the peace that comes from knowing God's will and desire for you? Isaiah 48:17-18 says, thus says the Lord, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel, I am the Lord your God, who teaches you to profit, who leads you in the way you should go. Oh, that you had paid attention to my commandments. Then your peace would have been like a river and your righteousness like the waves of the sea. You might be like the shepherds today. You're just minding your own business, not even knowing that you need direction from God. Just in this moment, would you just say, God, I'm open to your direction. I'm open to your leading. I'm just going to wait just for a moment. Just say, God, would you give me direction? Would you give our family direction? Would you give my housemates and myself direction? Would you ask the Spirit to direct you right now? Dive into what God's word says about your circumstances. Trust that God will speak to you perfectly because he loves you. Psalm 32 says, I will instruct you and I will teach you the way that you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you. Be not like a horse or a mule without understanding, which must be curbed by bit and bridle, or it will not stay near you. So God, that's what I'm praying for my friends tonight, today, that they would become, all of us would become people that listen for your direction, that just like the shepherds who were just minding their own business, God, and you broke in on their lives, I pray that you would break in on all of our lives and give us direction. May we not be afraid, God. May we not be terrified. May we not hide from you, and may we not be disobedient. May we be courageous to do what you've called us to do. God, we want to be people that know your will, that do your will, and that follow you. God, help us to make room for you this Advent season. In Jesus' name, amen. If you're here today and you've never made a decision to make room for Jesus in your life, I want to encourage you to make that decision today. The Bible tells us that today is the day of salvation. And becoming a Christian, although a giant decision, is a simple one. We just have to say to Jesus, here's my heart. Here I am, all my flaws, all my failures. Jesus, I believe that you died for me and I want to live for you. And maybe you've never prayed a prayer inviting Jesus to come into your life. I want to encourage you to do that today, to begin that journey. This prayer is not magical in any sense of the way, but it is a heart calling out to God. And God says that if we'll come close to him, that he'll come close to us. And the great thing is we can just, wherever we are in our kitchen, you don't need to be in a church or in a certain posture. It's just a heart posture where we say, God, I trust you. Help me to make room for you today. We're so excited. If you made that decision, would you just let somebody know? Maybe you could ask for prayer in the chat room. We'd be happy to pray with you, happy to connect with you, happy to drop a little package off at your home that will help you in this journey. We're so thankful that you're here with us today. Have a great rest of your day, Journey Church.
You know, you've heard this message today, and maybe God's been speaking to you. Feel like he's talking directly to you. In this moment, you have an opportunity to respond to him. Let me just pray for you today, and would you agree with me in prayer? Heavenly Father, I thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, that you've sent to give me life and hope. I receive you now into my life. I ask you to come in, transform me, change me from the inside out. I ask you to forgive me of the ways that I've walked in till this point and till this moment. I ask you to come into my life, transform me, make me a new person, and I receive you into my life in Jesus' name, amen. Listen, if you've made that, you said that prayer and you made a decision to follow him today, just let us know. We'd love to walk with you. We'd love to just come alongside of you. And if you have some questions, we'd love to kind of be there to help and support you. And maybe you've been walking with Jesus, but man, this has been maybe a difficult season, or you just recognize what God is saying in your life today, that you would like to respond to him, or you just need someone to pray with you. Click on live prayer there. Someone would love to pray with you. If you made that decision, click on yes, I said yes to Jesus today. And we would love to send some information your way and not bung up your inbox, but to really help you as you follow Jesus in these next days together. We are so thankful for you. We miss you like crazy. Thanks for joining us today. If you want to follow us online, follow our social media, follow us with our newsletter. You can just click that on simply at myjourney.church and just follow along in our newsletter. Sign up for that and you'll get weekly updates and what's going on. Lots of great, exciting things happening as we just kind of go into this season together. Watch the love of our Lord overtake every part of our lives. So thankful for you today. Bless you. Have an incredible week. We'll see you again next Sunday. Bye for now. Thank you.